Hi, my name is ThePrimeagen. I am a senior software engineer at Netflix, husband to a beautiful wife and a father of four kids. I created Blazingly Fast JavaScript because there are few people who know how to make JavaScript fast, and I wanted everyone to have a blazingly fast, great application. In this course, we'll cover how to use the Chrome dev tools, how to improve your application, and at the end, how to scrape the bottom of the barrel for the fastest possible JavaScript. I hope you use this course and make some blazingly fast JavaScript.
So I'm gonna do the world's simplest form of programming, which is I'm gonna just update this to use an array instead of a set. So if you'd like to follow along, please do. There's not too much code that has to be ran to get this to work. So I'm gonna first go up to the tippity top of the game/game.ts file, and I'm gonna just delete on each player's state. Instead of having bullets as a set, I'm just gonna delete it right off. We're gonna delete it from the player state. I'm gonna delete it from create state. And so there we go. So no longer, the players no longer have their own bullet sets. I'm gonna be really lazy about this and just kind of test the theory, does this actually work out? So I'm gonna go all the way down to the game, all the way down here. I know some of you see the word class and you vomit a little bit. Okay, calm down. Okay, sometimes state containers are a good thing. All right, Rust kind of has classes. I'm just saying, a lot of languages still have at least a notion of objects with functions on them. So calm down. All right, so I'm gonna go like this. Let's call it public bullets. All right, I'm gonna make it public because that way it's easy to update our tests. Pretty straightforward. So we have this nice little public function bullets in which I'm gonna go down to the constructor, this.bullets equals a new array. Fantastic. I'm just gonna put all the bullets into a single array and I'll check against that. Just see, is there even a there? We're not even being as efficient as we could be. I just want the bookkeeping to be simple. I just wanna prove something out. All right, so let's go down, all the way down to update. So we're gonna have some problems here. We can no longer use this. So I'm gonna go for let I, know again, people hate this idea of for loops, but they're actually quite nice, okay? You can run your own for loops from time to time. They're very simple and they can be quite performant, okay? So I'm gonna save a reference to the bullet. There we go. I'm gonna grab this update function, put it in there, and then after that, I need to check, hey, does this bullet hit player one? So I'm gonna delete that, put it in there, awesome. Now we can go down, I can just delete out that previous for loop, do it again. I'm gonna check, hey, do you hit player two? We're not even gonna be smart with our test. We just wanna, we're just seeing. So, do you hit player two? Yes or no? Okay, awesome. Delete that. And then lastly, I have to do this final for loop right here, which is I need to test these bullets against the rest, right? I need to see, hey, do you intersect any other bullets? So therefore we don't, we can remove those. So I'll just give it one of these and go let J equals, do you already know what I'm gonna do, Copilot? It's like Copilot's reading my brain. We need to go to effectively the next bullet in our list. So think of something like insertion sort. We go to the next item in the list and we're only gonna run what bullets are left because we've already tested the previous ones. And so there we go. And so now we're gonna check, hey, do you collide? So I'll go like this, const b2 equals this dot bullets j, awesome. So we have b2 versus b1. We'll log that out, but we can no longer use this. We don't need to have this whole bullets remove array. We can actually be kind of, we're gonna be a little bit more clever about this. I'm gonna go this.bullets.splice. If you don't know the difference between splice and slice, it's really not that hard. Splice takes things out, slice creates a view into. It's even in the name, you know, you can kind of guess what's happening here. So splice at j, remove one element. At I, minus minus, I know I'm being really tricky here, remove one element. So why am I doing that? Obviously j is one ahead of I, so we can just remove it safely because our collection that we're iterating over is on I. But I is currently pointed to an element that we're currently on. So if I remove that, I gets moved forward and then on our next loop, we would accidentally skip a bullet. So I'm gonna just set I back one so when we increment our loop, we're on to the next new item. Pretty straightforward, pretty easy. I know people don't love for loops, but hey, we're for looping, okay? They don't call me off by one prime for no reason here. So I feel pretty confident that we've just done this all first try pretty well. Very simple algorithm. It's still bullet squared for its running time, but maybe it is better. We just, again, just checking for a there. Lastly, we have this whole create bullet function, which attaches the bullet to the state. So we don't need to do that. I'm gonna go this.bullets.push. Boom, that's it. That's all we had to do make sure it's ready. Now, the good news is I did create a couple unit tests and one integration test, which, by the way, the integration test is just absolutely dog water. It may not work on your Mac. I just spawned a bunch of processes, definitely used some things that might be Linux only. I'm not even sure. But it mostly works, and sometimes it leaves a zombie process running, so you have to make sure you kill it. It just is what it is. I just wanted to prove to myself it somewhat works. So you can go like this, npm run test. And this should run four game tests, so long as, oh, look at that. Look at that, we forgot to do something. So let's go inside the test. So I'm gonna go inside the test, go to game, go to the next diagnostic. Look at this, see, before I was relying on the fact that we were using a test, we're not using a test, or we're not using a set anymore. So I'm just gonna go CI this and go game.bullets.length. Remember when we made that public? I wanna make sure it's zero. There we go, we've updated our interface. Absolutely wonderful. We're gonna rerun our tests, and what do we see here? Well, we should see four passing local tests. That's probably really good. The integration test does take 30 seconds to run because it literally spawns all the processes and plays one actual game, which takes about 30 seconds to get everything done. So absolutely fantastic. I'll let this one run out. We technically don't need this one to run out because we only changed how the game internal is played. This really shouldn't have any effect on the overall thing. But for the sake of completeness, we'll do it. Awesome. Then I'm gonna do this little LS of 42,000 kill 9. Yeah, it did look like we had our server still zombied there for a moment, but don't worry, it's dead now. So we know that the game is working. Everything is working fine. We made a really simple update to no longer use bullets, but instead use, or no longer use a set, instead use an array. And so I'm gonna do the exact same thing we did before. I'm gonna do a little TypeScript compile. We'll use inspect, and we'll launch it on the log path of testing. And I'm gonna go over here and run it with 1,000 again. And we should go back here and we should try to see, did we actually make this thing faster? Because before, update was taking effectively 14.4% of the time self time and 17.2 total time. Again, total time doesn't matter nearly as much as self time. So I'm gonna let this thing kind of get fired up. It's running, we're feeling fast. Maybe we're even feeling a little faster. I don't even know. So we're gonna record. Let's just see, did we make an actual dent here? So I'm gonna record this for 10 seconds. By the way, do we have any predictions of how much this will improve performance? Look at that, update is like gone. It's 3.8% of the time. What the heck happened? We didn't even do a great algorithm. It's like way faster. So sometimes don't just reach for sets. You don't always need to reach for sets. Okay, so we have a garbage problem. Yes, we aren't quite sure where the garbage is coming from. Looks like it's coming from a lot of places. So we know that all of these are contributing to this final number right here. Right, this is part of it. But what I see right here, right below update, is register destroy hook. Okay, if you don't know, that's more, that we're getting into the idea of node internal async hooks. You wanna guess what that's related to?
Promises.
Promises. Node has a lot of stuff. Look at this, init, which is 4% of the time that's on top. Guess what it's linked to? More async hooks. Okay, what about destroy? Async hooks. Okay, play game, that's us. Okay, that's us. This run micro micro tasks. Also, it's in some sort of task queues, probably not promises, maybe that's something else. List on timeout. Okay, this is some sort of timers internal. We are using a timeout. And that's 2% of the time that it's doing something and that involves a timeout. We have these emit hooks, again, async hooks. That's something. We have a before, async hooks. We have promise init hook destroy tracking, 1% of the time. Again, promises, promises, async hook, async hook, async hook. So there's quite a bit of code in here that's actually looking to be the majority of code that's executing is related to promises. And we also see a lot in memory being related to promises. So how much do you want to bet that promises, looking at both memory, which is like 20, 30% of the time, and in the code, which is looking literally like 20, 30% of the time, this could be a big W. I would say that this is probably gonna be a big W, and I have no idea because I've never done this before. So we're gonna find out now live, completely unpracticed. All right, so where are we creating these promises at? Hold on, I'm gonna make sure everything's all nice. Well, remember, our tick function is creating a promise every time we do a tick. So let's just do a little bit of math here, just a quick little bit of math. We'll do it in bash to make bad cop happy. We have a tick approximately every 16 milliseconds or 60 frames a second. We had, say, 1,000 games running. So we're doing, and then we're gonna do that. Let's see, so that's pretty much it. So that's 60,000 promises a second, right? That's a lot of promises per second. We're creating a ton of promises per second. But wait, there's more. Remember, that is this promise right here that we've created by awaiting. Oopsies, wrong one. But inside of here, if we sleep at all, we actually create another promise inside of that. So really, we're looking at potentially about 120,000 promises per second. So that's a lot of promises. That is a lot of things happening. And not only that, but promises have effects elsewhere. And so let's kind of look at those effects. Let's see, I wonder if I have, let's talk about the event loop for one quick second. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna kind of give us a basic intro into the event loop. You can imagine the event loop something like a loop, right? And what ends up happening is that every single time there is something to execute, it is added to a list. And this list could have several items in it, right? So we have a wake up from V8 saying, hey, you have data on your WebSocket. You need to handle this. It doesn't just execute, it doesn't just interrupt your program running because your program's running JavaScript. JavaScript is not multi-threaded. It will never be multi-threaded. It is never meant to be multi-threaded. It is just single execution. That's how it always has worked. And so even though there's things happening multi-threaded underneath, such as reading the network and doing all that, it doesn't mean JavaScript is multi-threaded. So maybe we have some data out on the socket. Okay, we need to go read that. Now we also have, say, one of those tick promises that need to be woken up from. We also have another tick promise that's gonna be woken up from, right? We can have a bunch of these. And as we read one piece of data, for us to be able to read that data, nothing can be executing. And how you leave the process event loop, or how you go back to the promise event loop, is that whatever is running needs to stop running. And then once nothing else is running, execution's handed back to the process event loop. We grab the latest one off the list, and now this is the thing that's executing while we wait. And maybe much, much more, maybe some more ticks happened in between there while we're waiting. It reads this, the WS library reads in that data, kind of creates the frames, makes everything nice. And then, oh no, some more data comes in. But where is that more data at? Well, it's gonna be down here. Right? It's gonna be somewhere else. It's gonna be way down here. It has to wait for the other things to execute before it gets its chance to execute in JavaScript. So everything gets in this nice little line to execute. So maybe we didn't get a complete frame here. So we have to wait till the next piece of data. So then we're gonna go here, we're gonna execute, we're gonna update the game, we're gonna update the game, we're gonna update the game, we're gonna update a game, and then we get a chance in here to finally go and go, okay, now let's finish off this frame. Okay, we got a frame, now the player can shoot. We're gonna add it to the queue and we're gonna wait for the next tick to happen so that it can shoot. And so you just gotta always kind of keep that in your head is that it's not free. Promises are not free. Because one thing that's really intense about promises is every single dot then or dot catch happens on the next cycle. It adds itself back to the event queue. There is just not a way to execute through a promise chain synchronously. And so that has real impact. So if you go 1, 2, 3, 4, and you have four promises that are executing synchronously, and you're getting thousands of requests, that 1, 2, 3, 4 will be interleaved with everybody else's 1, 2, 3, 4, despite the fact that maybe it is synchronous. And so maybe that one executes, and then 1,000 other people's ones execute. Then your two executes, and 1,000 other people's two executes. And then your three executes. So it can actually be really, it can have adverse effects onto how things are performing. We're still creating arrays over and over again. Is adding to the end and shifting off the front, is that a problem? Is that gonna cause a bunch of problems? Likely that is gonna cause a problem, because if V8 does something tricky, like tries to have, maybe it doesn't want to reorder all the indices, maybe it has some reasons when it doesn't reorder the indices, and you're literally growing one direction, maybe it's reallocating. We have no idea what's actually happening underneath the hood. And so a linked list test here could be really, really good. Should we create a linked list and actually remove off the front old-fashioned computer science style as opposed to using an array? There could be something that's really good here. We could even use a singly linked list so we're not doing a whole bunch of link breaking. We're only doing a singular link breaking every single time. which would just make it pretty fast. We could totally do that. These are just all the thoughts you got to start thinking about when it comes to this level, because at this point, there's no more free lunches. Everything is going to be excessively difficult to try to win. And so that's something I would most certainly try, is creating a linked list. The next thing, which is always pretty disappointing to just see in general, which is this right here. So do we ever consider our logging? I don't know. Are you considering your logging? Should you have a build step in which some servers just simply don't have logging? Some servers have logging, because every single time we get a collision, we're creating memory, we're creating strings, we're creating things all over the place. Are they gonna be useful? Are they not useful? Are you mutating the thing? So if I just take out all the logging, what happens now? And this isn't always a great idea to take out logging. I'm not saying you should do that, but you should potentially consider having a switch for when logging should and should not exist. And so we can most certainly take out this kind of stuff and then see how does this affect things overall. It's very funny. I've seen logging make more impact than almost anything else here. I'm also gonna just, let's bring this up a little bit. Let's go up to like 3,000. Let's just really try to generate more memory at this point.
Is the logger in this case the thing that's writing to your temp directory?
Yeah. It's the thing that's writing to the temp directory, sort of. No. The stuff that's writing the data to the temp directory is not that. That is going to be the data writer that's doing this extra kind of writing. This one that we're doing right now, this is just like the Pinot logger. So this would be like, I think pretty much every Node.js application in the universe uses Pinot for logging or some variant of that logger. Bunyan used to be the old one. So we're gonna let it run for a little bit longer. And hopefully we've made a difference. Also, one thing that you may not have noticed, when we go back here, you'll notice that there's always a small flat spot on run right here. There's always a small flat spot on run. Well, then when we removed those arrays, the flat spot went away. So we did actually take out the memory that was being generated in run, which is shocking that 240,000 arrays had very little impact into our system. And so now, as you can see, we have shrunk some things because now add player is now going to be is becoming a larger section. This before, add player was this little teeny tiny thin sliver, this teeniest tiniest thin sliver right here. And now after us removing the logger, it's really, really thick, which means proportionally that little piece of memory, which was like 1% of the total memory we were generating, is now like 20% of the total memory we're just generating. We really, like, unfortunately, this is one of those unfortunate parts about flame graphs. You don't actually, or the icicle charts, or however they call the ones that are upside down, you don't actually know the absolute difference here. You only see the relative difference. But the relative difference here is that we went from just, honestly, the tiniest amount right here, all the way to this. Like, that's a big difference. We are now producing very little memory.